Association, and then we have four panelists. And then starting with the surname Sei, Dr. the Honorable Jiang Chongtai. So he's from Legislative Councillor, Geographic Constituency, the New Territory West. Okay, so, and then Charles Mok is the IT Functional Constituency, and then Yu Chongyin Edward. Yep. And then from Architectural Surveying, Planning, and Landscape Functional Constituency. And then, of course, we have Dr. Ray Jung from City University App Lab, and then the sponsor of this the venue. Ooh. Yep. Okay. So, just very quickly, the rundown. First half, I will ask the panelists some questions, and then the second half, everyone can discuss. Okay. And then quickly, open data, free laws. Okay. So. What is open data? Okay, open data is some kind of data that we can find. First, we can find. Next, we can play with. A very important part of this is in a format that's very easy for us. Okay, so if it is an image format package in a PDF file, someone's still doing that. That's not good. Okay, and then the next, of course. Legally, we can share that. It means, yes, we have copyright. Copyright is a system that stops people from sharing. But of course, we have some license like Creative Commons that able to help everyone to share without fear, because the license is an international standard to share things. Okay, so that's very quick introduction. So, yes. For three of you, anyone of you want to start first with, have you ever tried to find data? Do you find it hard to find?
Yeah, who would I?
Charles, well, I have
to.
Okay, maybe let me start first.
Yeah.
Indeed, doing research on, say, land issue, real estate issue, indeed we require a lot of data, including census data. For academic, yes, indeed, we have a special channel. We can ask for some special data set from the Census and Statistics Department. But other than that, say, for example, I think all of you have heard about TPEDM, right?
No.
There's a scandal in Wangzhou incident.
Yep.
That the consultant, indeed, right, got the set of data from the planning department, but without their permission and violating the contract condition, they share the data set with a developer in helping the developer to apply for a rezoning application to the town planning board. So say, for example, in TPEDM is a very valuable data set which can tell you which district of Hong Kong, right, will be going to have more population, right, better transportation, and about right details forecast. So you will find right how important TPEDM is for planner. But unfortunately, indeed, we cannot assess. Even consultants, if they do not help, if they are not involved in government project, then they will not be able to assess to the TPEDM data set. So this is a very key example that indeed we need a lot of this important information, but they are available from the government department.
I'm Chung Tai Cheng. Let me briefly introduce my background. And I was trained as a sociologist, so that maybe like the content and the principle I share with you guys here, then we might be like, we can share more, I think. First, open data, or as what we call indigenous open data, not only represent Hong Kong, it's different from China. And the function, okay, the function of open data in Hong Kong not only help better governance, to me, is the status and also had a kind of symbolic meaning to constitute the status of Hong Kong. That means at least we can make use of the flow of open data and also information to guarantee that Hong Kong, we can have certain degree of self-determination. So, well, to me, what data did we try to find, or maybe I a little bit like rephrase the question, the Hong Kong people or us, we should own that data. I won't see it as a kind of like technical question or technical issue only. It's a kind of social, political, and also technical issue in Hong Kong, especially in such political context. Well, first, the differences between Hong Kong and mainland China, I mean, the most important part is that we can guarantee the flow of information, as I think. Not only mean that we can have our own currency, we can have our own legal and political system. And the most difference between Hong Kong and China, because we enjoy the freedom of the flow of information in such capitalist system. So that guaranteeing like the openness of data, okay, is the way that how we try to distinguish Hong Kong and China. And second, in this like 10 more years, we put much more like emphasis on the degree or also the openness of public participation in policymaking processes. And open data is the way that how Hong Kong people, we can build a stronger sense of belonging and also citizenship with such style of governance. So this mean that if we have like better and like open, more open data, I mean during the policy making process, that means our Hong Kong society could become more liberal, okay? But may not be the sense of democratic, but at least a liberal city state. And third, as like the opening, as I mentioned, in these few years, it seems like the Hong Kong people, we recognize the so-called the rise of localism or our local identity, just put it simply. So I think in practice, we enjoy the flow of like data and information, open data and information. But in this few like years, it seems during the policy making process, the Hong Kong government and also like the CCP, then is trying to destroy the system we have like taken for granted for such flow of information. Okay, the flow of information. So that I won't say like it's hard to fight. I think that the Hong Kong government, like to the Hong Kong citizens, it should be like the practitioner and also the facilitator of open data, rather than they own the data. So that like in policy, like practice, for example, we should have the data like from the so-called people or immigrant of the one permit system. But in Hong Kong, then we just simply don't have that data. Then why? Then we all don't know why. And indeed, this represents the rights and also the, as what I mentioned, the symbolic meaning of like self-determination in that sense. So, maybe I like that's the my ideas. So, maybe during the discussion, I can share with you more examples. Like Charles,
Dr. Rachel first.
Sure, thank you. Thank you for the comment. So I would like to quickly introduce what the abstract is about before I start telling you more about my perspective. So the Apps Lab is trying to create what we call a platform that allow university students and also faculty that can work on research project, okay, to develop mobile apps. Okay, so we need to deal with any kind of data. I would like to take three examples. Okay, the first example that I would like to tell you today is about what we call the CTU mobility app. So it's about a professor in the public policy domain. So the idea is, let's say today we spend our time in this room. So the app itself, it will trigger an event, okay? So after a day, we will get like a 10 event of a day. So imagine we've got millions of people. And then that kind of data will be actually stored, and that can actually create some kind of what we call the policy effect. So this is what we will try to create, first element, okay? And the point is that we are getting a lot of personal data, and in that sense, are we going to open that like anonymous personal data? That is my question number one. Second project that I would like to share today is about a project with the Hong Kong police. So you know Hong Kong, we've got so many like a scam call all the time, and we need to know whether this phone number is actually a thief. They want to get your money. So we develop what we call a mobile app, and that app is actually trying to validate, okay, the number with the Hong Kong police. So we need certain kind of mechanism to validate that kind of numbers. Okay, so are we going to open up that data as open data? This is my second question. So another angle project I would like to share today is recently, the university, we are working on a big project. Okay, so we're trying to collect what we call the SCADA data, okay, S-C-A-D-A, supervisory control and data acquisition data. So you know there are a lot of control system in the water department, EMSD, civil department, and so on. So we need to get all these SCADA data. The way we can get these data is, at the moment, is we need to talk to all these departments. And I would say they're very helpful, okay? But the problem we encounter is the level of detail. Okay, are they actually providing the right data? Because this is a kind of internal data, okay, I want to say. So we are facing all these issues that we need to identify and sort out before we can actually carry out the research project. And that's my perspective. And I believe open data is important for Hong Kong. Yes, thank you.
Okay, for Charles Moore, I have something more difficult. Okay, so from my knowledge, this is the last visible policy from the government that the government call open data public sector information. And then if there's any such data, they should be open by default. Okay?
Default. Where do you see by
default? As default. Oh, okay. Yes. So, but of course now we have the ITB, and then ITB have its own aims. So, of course Charles is not representing the government, but as a person who you know follow up all this so closely. So, what's your best guess of government stand on open data policy?
Okay, I think they know the term, but they don't know what to do. first of all, I think they follow the global trend. The United States and other government over the last many years, they begin to talk about open data, basically in the spirit of opening up all these information so that the public or researchers or anybody, the media, can use the data to derive knowledge, provide services, create opportunities, and so on, right? This is the concept. But in reality, even though the government has set up, this is no longer data.one.gov.hk, but data.gov.hk, right? Since after 2014. So the government has set up this data.gov.hk, open data portal. But the reality is, oftentimes, I think many people around here would find that, you know, the information that they want to get, they won't get it. But the information that they don't need or the information that are provided in redundant way and so on, they will get it. And the reality is the governments do not really measure themselves by the quality or what is the most important data that needs to be made public. But instead, they measure themselves, if they measure themselves at all, they measure themselves by quantity, not quality. So every year they will come to LegCo or tell the public that, oh, last year we had 5,000, so this year we have 6,000, next year we have 7,000. But and then many people, most of the people would then tell me that a lot of it is just RSS feed. You know, some of these are just you know, one data set broken up into 5 or 10,
yep.
And so
translations.
On.
Translations.
Or translation, different
yeah.
languages,
yeah.
or simplified and traditional characters, and then they count it at 2 or 3 times. You know, it's just making up numbers. In reality, so that's why I said they do not really understand what open data is. On the other hand, one reason is possibly because of the fact that the departments that is responsible for this open data initiative is just the Office of the Government Chief Information Officer. So imagine the IT department telling all the other bureaus, you have to open up this data, you have to open up that data. They have no power to do that. So all the other departments ignore them and just basically, you know, dokso, give them some numbers and say, you know, okay, I'll give you 10. If you want, I'll give you 50 data set, but they're useless. So that's the reality. And then we come back to why this is the situation. I think one is the philosophical problem that a lot of the government bureaucrats still have. They still are under the impression that if I tell you more about what we are doing, you will have, and you, people especially like the two of you and me, will have more ammunition to criticize the government. So only experts understand this sort of thing. You are not expert, so you do not understand. I don't give it to you. It's a waste of my time, and so on. So that's the philosophical problem, I think, with many of our civil servants, number one. And second, I think if you look at the legal aspect, open data is just the administrative or the technical aspect of opening up data. Coming back to why government do not open up these information, like the Wangzhou information, we see that number one, there is no archival nor in Hong Kong. So, you know, the government don't even tell you, or actually they tell you that they don't keep minutes. They have no idea what was talked about in the meetings or Mo Dai or whatever, because they are not obliged to keep all these minutes or records for themselves. So that's why we need the archival law first. And second, after they have kept all this information, they need to have the Freedom of Information Law, where right now in Hong Kong, we only have a guideline. So in other words, a guideline, there's no legal enforcement power. That means the government can find any one of 1,000 kind of excuse to say, I'm not going to give the information to you arbitrarily. So that's useless. So three things in terms of legal, we need to have the archival law and then the freedom of information law and then even open data law. Because right now we look at the US and some other countries in Europe and so on. They're even this piece of direction that the government put
yeah.
out as sort of a nice thing that they say, oh, I'm going to do, put it in law.
Okay.
Other countries are beginning to do that. But for Hong Kong, it's very difficult to do that right now because to start with, we don't even have the step one and step two, which is the archival law and the freedom of information to make sure the government have to open up all these information. And then the third step, this is only the third step, which is opening up in the right format. So that's the problem we have. I think we have at least three big steps behind.
Okay. All right, so the next question would be, oops. Okay, why open data? Why open data is important? So, for our organization, we are supporting a project called the Free Hong Kong Funds. The EDB is recommending the teachers to write like this, okay? But as you can see on their website, this is from EDB website, this is a flash, but when they use a system font, it have a different writing because this is the Taiwanese fonts. So they recommend some writing, but there's no font to use. A lot of teachers, they were very frustrated because they have to use white marker to mark out a lot of the Taiwanese font writing and then get it right. And then this is our project. And how can we get this project running? Is we change some of the fonts from a Taiwanese-based font, okay? From here, because Taiwanese, they have open data, and then they open up fonts, one of the fonts that they made, funded by the government. So we took the Taiwanese font to build a font that fits the Hong Kong education recommendation. And then we got elderlies to edit fonts, and we got, quite some media coverage. And so for us, it's important because we wouldn't have that project because if we don't have that open data from Taiwan. So, and also I want to mention, there's a lot of, we talk quite a lot about the government, but I also want to remind all of you that a lot of the NGOs, and for example, the bus companies, they also have a lot of relevant data. Okay, so, and also for commercial company, some of the big companies, they also have a lot of data. So in our discussion, I think we can also talk about them. Okay, so all four of you, why is open data important and what will you do? Like how important open data, what will you do?
So me again, right? Yeah, so first of all, PSI mentioned by the government as free reuse is definitely a lie. So say for example, if we would like to know about the lease condition of this land, it costs you $180. And if you would like to buy right all the GIS data provided by the lands department, it costs me about $1 million. And then all the transaction data in the past 10 years of housing, it cost me another $1 million. So they are expensive. They are available indeed. But I think more interesting for all of you to know, more recently, Lands Department has installed a new software. They have drones to fly right every month. And with a software, by means of those photos, they can now detect any structure built in the new territories, any brownfield, right, or any change of land use. So indeed, they know everything. They have the data set, but unfortunately, they are not open. And another example, when I work in Chinese University of Hong Kong, indeed our team had developed a new model with four drones, fly to different altitudes, and then collect different pollutants data, so as to identify whether those pollutants comes from a roadside by vehicles or from, say, ships or our power plant or from elsewhere. So these are some of the project that we are undergoing, and hopefully those data can become open data later on. Yeah.
First, I think like the global trend and also the Hong Kong government, they are trying to promote the idea of so-called smart city. And like such kind of idea, I don't think that is new to the like dominant Western countries. But to Hong Kong, then it's quite new to us. New in the sense that we used to wait for the government to provide us data. But indeed, quite a lot of like NGOs or the public organizations, they have that kind of data in hand. But the problem is that we cannot combine the already like have data in the society within and during the policy making process. So that like no matter the Guangzhou incident or the like development plans in new territories, the first difficulty we are facing is that we cannot really do a kind of so-called impact assessments. I think that, well, open data is not just like data we try to like predict or solve the problems. It's the way how we can make use of the data instill in or embed in our everyday life so that we can improve our quality of life at the end. So why that's important? So in terms of like better governance, I would say that this is the only way how our Hong Kong people, we make use of a so-called like bottom-up way to combine and also to generate the data we already have. But just like Charles, he said that, luckily, unfortunately, we did not have such kind of regulations and laws to protect and also to guarantee the data could be shared. So that is like the legal difficulties or barriers we have to handle. And other aspects, I think this is also why we need to have open data. It's just given we are close to China. Okay, I'm sorry. And why? Because to me, the assumption, okay, somewhat is that the open, I mean, the more open of data, the better competition of like so-called not accurate or so-called wrong information. And as we know that, like Hong Kong, we used to enjoy quite like so-called free markets in a way that the flow of information and the decision which are made by the entrepreneurs or the companies that help we generate healthy data or concrete data or accurate data, okay? And now that, why it become a problem? It's not the problem like maybe related to like politics term, but it just given, well, we're close to that large economy. And so Hong Kong, we are quite like sensitive to the external so-called influences in terms of like economic and also political so-called environments. So that we need to have like open data in a way that we need to prevent the risk we may have. For example, the financial like crisis or what happened in China. Okay, maybe I draw one example. One data we are quite interested to know about that. We could like to know the number of gold which is transported through the custom from mainland China to Hong Kong. Then why? Because this is the indicator to us how worse the China economy. And also this indicator to the Hong Kong people how important our Hong Kong as a so-called free or black market. Okay, anyway. So that this data indeed is available like in the department of like the some like related departments. But to the general public we all don't know that. But that is a quite significant like index for us to know how we try to prevent the next crisis of like so-called China bomb or like global financial crisis. So well, that's why like no matter in terms of the local better governance and also a global, I mean Hong Kong as a global city, we need to have that open data.
Yeah. What will you do? Will you ask the government in LegCo or like?
Well, for sure, I will support Charles and to facilitate the so-called legalization of like free data. But at the same time, I think that this may need the so-called civil society,
okay,
to help so-called civil society to help from the so-called the ground. For example, like New Territory East, then now that the Hong Kong government, we don't have like concrete so-called like data of like population changes indeed. So that, but the local NGOs, indeed they can have that figures in the proper estate, for example, that do need. So that in terms of the regional like governance, that's the way how we can try to like combine the data. And I know that there's already like Brisbane government, I mean in Australia, they try to make use of that regional and district information to have a better like plan and also impact assessment for their own development. But Hong Kong, Well, the Hong Kong government just tried to control the power, the authority, like in a centralized way. Indeed, like the local and district like information, sorry, district level, they can have such like information sharing. So that's we can try to promote.
Yeah.
So,
sure. As a faculty member at City University, education is very important. So I'll continue to do three things. The first one is to support the open source community to bring in more students. I can see some of my students actually here today. Yeah, Horace, yes. So we would like to promote more students to join this type of event to bring up the awareness. Okay, this is what I will do. Second thing is, as you may know, in Hong Kong, the curriculum, the degree program is also transforming. Like UST, Hong Kong U, even CTU, even my department, we recently revamped our program. Actually, we changed the program to computer and data engineering. So we insert more element related to data. But the point is, are we just focusing on data analytics or big data? And I think the concept of open data is also very important. So I think we will continue to advocate the idea. And then the third thing, I think, will be the high school sector. So I think we can't just do this in the university level. I think it should be like an ecosystem. We need to continue to drive this initiative.
What will I do? I think two things. Number one, awareness. And I think recently, open data as a whole in the community, I think more people are beginning to understand it. You know, some of the, for example, recently I had a video with an argument between myself and the Transport and Housing Secretary and about the definition of open data and so on. I think that is useful. Really, sorry about that to him, but it's actually quite useful to arouse people's interest and understanding about what is open data, what is really open. And it's not just opening some data or information up through a government interface only. What the second thing that I would do is, as I mentioned, there are three steps that needs to be taken in terms of the legal framework that we need to guarantee that there will be open data, truly open data. So the first step is the archival law. We have already, myself and some of the volunteers, experts in the area, have drafted a first draft of the a law, a members' bill for archival law. That's the first step. It's very difficult to make the three together all in one step. So we decided that we will first push the archival law as a members' bill, probably in the next year. You know, after this session, we will start to do that. Procedurally, we need to submit that to the Justice Department so that they will have a look and then finalize some of the legal wordings and so on. And then we will need the approval from the president of LegCo and also the chief executive, whoever that will be later on, to agree to let us push this bill forward. Usually, they would not allow it. But it is a way to put pressure on the government so that the government sometimes may say, okay, I know, you need to do this, okay, fine. Let me do my own version, which is better than my version, or more acceptable to government, at least. So it's a way to putting pressure on the government. So first, we will push the archival law, myself and a few other legislators. We are coordinating this together with Tania Chan and Dennis Kwok. So we hope to be able to push it in the next year, and I'm sure many of our colleagues will also support and hopefully do that first, and then followed by freedom of information and open data. Yes.
Okay.
Sure, but Charles, may I raise a question? So about the difference in definition of open data. So say for example, if now the government provide those that we can read, but we cannot use.
Right.
So what would your suggestion? Should we make use of our civil society to retire it, or
good
urge the government?
Yes, very good question. A very good observation. In fact, there are a lot of these so-called open data in the data set that the government currently is providing that either is not very convenient to reuse or they only in some cases they only provide real-time data but not a historical basis, like the month of February or whatever. They don't let you have it. But then you say, can we retype it? Can we
store it,
and so on? Then you would run into a copyright issue because they haven't really made it very clear. They say, oh, you're free to use it, but they haven't made it very clear as a copyright statement saying that no right reserved. So you're really free to do anything. They didn't really say that. They didn't use Creative Commons. If they used Creative Commons, so there are certain conditions and it is a proper licensing given, they don't have that either. So it's unclear. So that is the problem. So I think we need to push the government to do better. In the meantime, you know, before we can say, you know, we have all these legal infrastructure ready, which might really take some time. But in the meantime, I think the public awareness and pushing them to not just open up more data, but also, you know, in a more quality way. And that's what hopefully the community awareness would allow us to push the government to do those things better.
Okay, so I promise everyone that you can ask questions. So anyone want to ask them any questions?
So as frustrated data users who've never managed to access open data because we don't really have any in Hong Kong, what can we do? You know, you're saying what will you do? Like, what can we do as citizens, as civil society groups?
Next question will be, what can the community do?
Yeah.
Okay, so, yes.
What do you think? Do you, let them. What do
process.
Yeah, Bastion, what do you think?
Data process. Give us our data.
Lobby our legislative councillors.
Lobby the government, yeah. Okay, easy to lobby us. Lobby them.
Yeah, please, yes.
So if you get a chance to be the next chief executive in Hong Kong anytime later, what is your first priority data that you will decide to share?
You mean we would want him to share? Okay, I will just tell you the kind of information, maybe not five because we don't have that much time, but I'll tell you a couple of the information that I have been asking the government for many, many years and they don't provide it. Number one, Section 161. Crime Ordinance, Section 161, access to a computer with dishonest or criminal intent. I have been asking for the government to provide data about about prosecution of these categories of crimes that they have been prosecuting using this particular access to a computer with dishonest or criminal intent, and they have never been they have never provided this information to us. Second, I have been asking the government for many years to give us the information about the number of warrants that they have issued to local internet service providers to get data or personal information from these companies. But they never provide the number to us, despite we've been asking for them for many years. So these are just a couple of the examples that I have been trying to push the government to open up. And certainly, it would take a couple of clerks to go into the file and do some counting for a few days, or at most, and they will get the answer. But they always say, we don't keep that data. Why we don't keep that data? Can you do it now, from now on? And he said, we don't keep that data.
Yes, any other data set?
Maybe let me try. Indeed, I have mentioned many of them already. The first one is about a lease. Right, say for example, whether your land your site, the lease would be expired in 2047.
Mm.
Right, this kind of information indeed is quite costly nowadays. This is the first one. The second one is all the transaction data. So say for example, just last week, I hope one group of redress, they complained that ULA underestimate their housing value, and they would like to make a better estimation. So I asked them to find those transactions nearby in order to make a better estimation. So if we can have a free reuse of all housing transaction data, then it can help a lot of people. And the third item is about the planning information. So nowadays, all the outline zoning plans, I mean, right, say for example, this piece of land, what would be the land use allowed, right, by the town planning ordinance. But interestingly, nowadays you can read, but you cannot use the data. So this is another example. So so the first item would be this zoning information. And then, and the fourth one, as I mentioned before, all the building information. Indeed, I have chat with your teammate. It's so weird that every April,
okay. Then
there will be a 1 month window that you can retrieve the data from the rating evaluation department, right? About the size, about the age, about the weightable value, right? Quite a lot of information about buildings. But interestingly, only 1 month open window. And if you do not know that, then right, you miss the chance, then you cannot get it. So then if we can have all this building information, then indeed it helps, right, the society a lot. And the fifth one, of course, is TBEDM, about the projection of future population, transportation, and infrastructure, right, of the city.
Thought that y'all includes like the most important factors. Well, you know, like, to me, the first data I think the general public we interest to have is the number of crime rate for the like policemen. Yao banking. Well, that's a number we cannot have right now, the concrete number. And well, this is just like a joking. But you know, to me, what we need to have first, indeed, Hong Kong, we all know that we are facing the so-called like aging population, yeah, aging society. And so, why land and lease and all the demographic, sorry, and all the other demographic data that are that important to us is only one reason. Right now, we cannot plan for the future. Yeah, we do not have the data, we do not have that information to plan for our future. For sure, the government may say that you don't need to have that data because they plan for you. And the only way is to combine Hong Kong and mainland China at the end, maybe it's like 20 years later. So, apart from like those like areas Dr. Yao he mentioned, so I think that what data we need to have is the number of money, and also no matter like the government, if they are so politically count or they are in the black market from mainland China and through Hong Kong to the global financial economies. So that's the way that how we can guarantee in Hong Kong we are still so-called like free market, but and also the way we know one day, maybe we have no money through Hong Kong. Yeah, and then that's why that's important, because right now, I mean, like to the Hong Kong citizens, we don't have the books, but at least we can earn money in Hong Kong. But we don't know that like may one day the stock market and also our property markets, they may just combine with the mainland China. And so that's need the flow of information to guarantee our market is healthy.
thank you for the good question. I actually couldn't think of five important data, but I would say any kind of data that is relevant to research, I think that would be very useful. And also, I would say the data that can actually improve the quality of life of us and also for the minority, and that would be great just for me. I think it's very important to have a platform that can actually facilitate people to share the data and also retrieve the data. And that's the thing I would like to see.
Okay, so we have... Oh, one more question, is it? Okay, okay, one more question.
Yeah, for the open data, more I concern, yeah, because I understand why the government don't understand what open data is, because for the Hong Kong yearbook or census, all the data that actually you can find in the traditional way, either data or something like that. So that because the open data opens the terms open, actually it couldn't represent so clear what is the open data the principle at the time. But more important, what I think is that, okay, even for government itself, there are documents inside the government, different data, different departments' data, they could not communicate with each other because they do not have any open protocol, open format. Okay. Yeah, and then what I know is that around 2009, Taiwan government has done a research and then have a report on, I think it's 2010, to say that the government document format should be something like, okay, using this open format, okay, then every document should be used this format so that for the other departments, easy to access, for the public to be easy to access. Is there any scheme in the government or research or proposal report inside the government itself? Because we know that for the ESD, the electronic service or something.
Delivery, they don't even use that term anymore.
Because that's around 2000,
yeah.
The time in 2000. And do they do the deep research at that time? Because it doesn't say that just everything could be just public to the website is fine. Because even the department itself, they couldn't communicate with each other. So that is it. Did they have to do a deep research on what the electronic files of the document is? So that the archival law is one of the things quite important. But the other thing I think that the government should be have some open protocol, something that could be used inside the government and also for the public, for the companies. Otherwise, for open data itself, it's really hard to push. Because even I just open the links, all the different systems are using different protocol. It's still really hard to do the things.
One of our proposals is for the government to create a position called the Chief Data Officer. And I think they should hire you to do that. Because I don't think anyone in government has the idea of what you are talking about. But you are very right. Is there any initiative inside the government to try to unify these document format and so on? The answer is that I am aware of, no. The only thing that is remotely similar to what you are talking about, and the government will likely come to the Legislative Council to get some funding to proceed to do this in the next several months, is a communication system, basically like an email system, internal communications or email messaging system that will finally replace Lotus Notes. Okay, so you can see how backward and how behind our government is. Hong Kong government is probably the most siloed government among the major large cities or modern cities or countries. You don't need to compare with, you know, I don't know.
They're still using 40.
Yeah, well. So anyway, the only thing that is most closest to what you're talking about is they're trying to unify or replace the very old Lotus Notes that's still being used by some government with a newer messaging system. But not in terms of document format. And recently, I have also been made aware of another similar issue. It's about not really just technical issue. It's also about data classification, information classification. Like in an organization, you classify something as confidential, something as sensitive, or whatever. You have several layer, a different classification of confidentiality. Right now, we're using a system that is very old. And according to many people that are experts in the area, number one, many of these documents in government are needlessly classified to be a very high confidentiality level. That is not only problematic for people like us or researchers trying to get information, it is also problematic when it comes to we IT people saying that, can you use a cloud service? They say, I cannot use a cloud service because, not talking about personal data, but because of some of these information that are accidentally or routinely classified as too high of a confidentiality level, and then they have to buy their own servers and do their own computer rooms and so on, because only because of that, and they cannot put it on the cloud because of this very outdated classification system, which has been made aware of. I've been made aware of this problem by some of the cloud service providers as well. So it does impact on many different areas in terms of technology adoption, as well as information access and the freedom of accessing these information by the citizens. So you have the right idea. We're trying to tell the government that these are important, and I hope that we can finally get them to listen to us.
Yeah, so that's the minister doing something? Yeah, because actually for me, I know that the UK government changed their document thing. Around 2000, yeah, so that around 20 years almost, now they can do the open data itself, they can do the classified things that much easier than in the time. So, because there's example for them to prefer.
May I add one question? You just share the Taiwan example. I'm not sure. You're talking about the G0V.Taiwan.
Why
I would draw that example, the budget. G0V.Taiwan. I think that's the idea of the civil society, or what we try to promote, is a bit different. The government they provide the protocol to have better data management and categorization. That's one part. But Taiwan, why this can be better? The way how they try to improve the situation of open data is the society. The civil society themselves, they really cherish their own data. So that the indigenous open data is rather important than the government part. But the way that they try to have the idea, the government should be zero time. That means all the time they need to be transparent. Then how we maintain or guarantee they are transparent, that the civil society. Yeah, so I agree that the government, they need to have that technological development. But the core part is how we Hong Kong people, we really know the differences between information, data, knowledge, and the other so-called ideas.
Yeah, because what I think is that when you want to encourage government to do something, then you should talk about something benefit for them. Okay, so that open data is benefit for them is not only for the open government. Yeah, because they are afraid with that thing because of, that the CCP don't want people to access some data. But the problem is that, you have to tell them, if you do open protocol, let's just cut down into open protocol, then they will have more efficiency with the different department. so that when you do some checking with different departments' data, that will be faster. You need not to wait for 1 month or 1 week, so that you can just instantly get the data and then can have more efficiency. For the open data part, of course, we want to encourage because we are taxpayer. The copyright things, we also pay money for the government to do those data research or something, so that we have a property on. If we say that we, because we pay money on it, so that those data is we have right to access. That's why the open data things now is coming. Yeah, because it's quite different from the current copyright things.
Okay. Yes, actually we only have about 1 minute left. What do you have to, here's the community. What do you, do you have anything, ask them for help or anything that we can collaborate? Yep, here's the people that are interested in open data.
Yeah, maybe let me try first. Indeed, I'm going to organize an activities. First of all, we would like to have an open GIS platform for all people, right, to be able to add information, photos into it. And then I'm going to have competitions among secondary school students. Then they can say, for example, the first event would be about heritage in community. And then you, if you can help to build such a platform, a GIS one, and then different community students can learn how to use to insert about stories, photos, right, about their heritage, their culture, and then it becomes a common shareable database for all of us.
Maybe a last point, like, I'd like to share. I think we can just like start from the public transportations. The government, the role, like how we can urge them to like enjoy the benefit of the open data is not only on the government part, it's the way that they need to urge the public organizations they share open data. So that point, that means why public transportations? Because like open data, we are not talking about historical facts or historical data. We are talking about real time. That's quite an important part in I think open data in that sense. So well, the flow of transportations and also how like the number of buses or the frequency of buses like pass through the Twin Moon Highway or etc. That's like the way how we can have at least like better arrangement of our everyday life. So the point is not historical, it's real time things that affect our daily life.
Yes, I know today is the Open Data Day. In the world, there are 332 events ongoing just for today, including Shanghai, Taiwan, and Hong Kong in Asia. So I would say the community is here. And as you know, in university, like what we are doing, we try to create a community. And those students, they need to know more about what's going on, you know, in the society. So that's why I would encourage all of you to come over to CTU more often, at least to other universities as well, to talk to the student to open up their mind. So I think this is important. Thank you.
I think other than the helping us to get the message to the community of the importance of open data and educate each other, I think I would also be very interested in getting your experience of which are the kind of open data from which department you have not been able to get. Sometimes, even though I cannot guarantee that I can help you get those data open for you, but I think if we develop a channel to talk to these departments and let them understand, as you said, you know, let them understand that this is actually going to help them, rather than, you know, make them give them more work or whatever. I think that is a part of the education process too. So when you run into some problems that of some of these information that you think you want to get and you cannot, I love to hear about that and consider whether we can try to help you approach those departments and try to solve that problem. And even if not, at least we have the knowledge about what are, where the problems are. You know, it's sometimes very different from one department to another. And sometimes I think if, let's say you asked about the secretary or the minister, let's say, what is the secretary of for information and technology? Is he doing anything about it? To be honest, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, otherwise he should call up Anthony Cheung and say, you know, this is open data. You should understand it and teach him. But I doubt that any of such conversation ever, never exists, this kind of. But anyway, so if they don't do it, at least we try to do it, okay?
Okay, so unfortunately we only have 1 hour, so thank you very much for our 4 panelists. Yeah. Yeah. And, thank you very much for all.